Neil deGrasse Tyson is with us. He's a leading astrophysicist, also director of the Hayden Planetarium at the American Museum of Natural History. The new book is Space Chronicles, Facing the Ultimate Frontier. And it's a fascinating book, and one of the things you go into is how for so long the idea of space exploration was not really politicized. NASA was a group that was, for the most part, supported by both of the two sides we have in American politics. But that, as of late, that's actually started to change, and that now there does seem to be kind of a political side to whether or not it makes sense to fund NASA. How did that come about?
Well, first, let me correct you. NASA has always been political. The difference is it's now partisan.
I see.
That's an important distinction. NASA was created in a political climate, in the geopolitics of the Cold War. So, and I can understand and accept, I don't have to like it, but I certainly accept the reality that politics has always orbited NASA. What concerned me deeply in the past decade, going from Bush, George W. Bush to Barack Obama, is that I've seen partisan side-taking and partisan bickering tainting the dialogue of what the present and future of NASA needs to be.
And when you look at what the future should be, I mean, what's the ideal scenario, right? I mean, we have on one side the kind of point of view that space exploration is, because it's not a necessity, it should be something that we leave to private industry and let government fund other things. And at the same time, you have those who say, well, we've tried that in other areas of life and it's not gone anywhere. I mean, where should it be in your opinion?
There's a lot of misunderstanding about the private sector, and many people think that NASA is ceding their preeminence as the leader of space exploration to private industry. That's just false. It's not only false. Private industry cannot lead a frontier because the private industry is not conceived to do so. What private industry does is it asserts a capital marketplace when you can value the risks and the dangers and quantify the costs of that adventure. When you're advancing a space frontier, it's expensive, it's dangerous, the risks are unknown. When you combine those three, you cannot market that to investors. It just doesn't work that way because you have no way to say what the return on the investment will be. So the history of major exploratory missions has always been led by governments. And once you've drawn the maps, and once you assess the dangers and know where the trade winds are and what the costs will be, then you cede that to private enterprise, and then they do it more efficiently than you, and they can be inventive, and you basically spawn entire new industries for having done so.
It's interesting that as the idea of space exploration has become more and more partisan, as you mentioned, we're also seeing the idea of science become much more and more partisan, where there is clearly one political party in this country who seems to kind of resist the influence of science and investigation, and there's one party that, in theory, tends to support it somewhat more. I mean, from your point of view, I'd be fascinated to know, what do you think when you see candidates, particularly in the Republican Party, talk about, well, evolution is one of many theories that is kind of out there, and it's really no different than the theories presented or the ideas presented by religion, for example. Is that a positive thing for the country or negative?
I see that as a symptom of the fact that we live in a world today, we live in a country today, where science and engineering are not, they're not folded in to our sense of self and our sense of our identity, as they were back during the heyday of the Apollo program. During Apollo, science was the engine that generated economies. Science and technology were the forces that would enable the tomorrow that you dreamt of to be brought into today. So I assert that 30, 40 years ago, science and engineering was seen and received in a much more welcome way by all aspects of society than it is today. So I'm going to make the audacious assertion that if you double NASA's budget and we go back into space in a big way, advancing a space frontier, then the innovation culture that would exist in NASA to have to realize that frontier then will then permeate the country. And it's that innovation culture that makes people wealthy. And when that happens, people then see the value of science and engineering, and I think all these debates go away.
Do you really? So you think that some of these kind of incredible debates about the science of, of global warming, or the exact time at which someone is a person as it comes to conception and the abortion debate. I mean, all of these things you think might be just pushed absolutely out of the mainstream if science is taken more seriously.
Yes, because what will happen, I'm not saying they'll go away, but I'm suggesting that right now people don't see or feel what science is doing to them. They've grown accustomed to their iPhone. They've grown accustomed to flying at 500 miles an hour at 31,000 feet. When you advance a frontier, new things are coming at you all the time. Okay, so we do have advances in, in telecommunications. Yes, I have an iPhone today that 10 years ago I'd be burnt at the stake for wielding if I was discovered holding one. So not that society does not have advances, but the kinds of advances that come about from grand epic adventures, that's a whole other scale. And when that scale pervades culture, then it becomes part of how we think about the world. The world is not just what I want it to be. The world is as it is revealed to us through the methods and tools of science. If you're not in a position to understand or embrace those facts, then you're going to feel like the world should be just whatever you think it should be. So there'd be a force operating against that kind of thinking if we had science appearing on the headlines every day.
Let's talk a little bit about space exploration specifically. I mean, in your mind, there are a number of different reasons why some say it's a good idea or a bad idea to explore space, right? And this ranges from adventure, like you said, to, hey, we might need a new planet to go to if and when we destroy this one. What do you see as the biggest reason to explore space to the max, so to speak?
All of those are great reasons. They're just not good enough to force anyone to write a fat check to enable it. You can go down the list. It's in our DNA. We're for science. We're explorers. We're Americans. It's fundamental to our identity. You can go down the list. But the history of the world tells me that none of those reasons are sufficient to dislodge major funds from a Congress, from a check-writing Congress. But what is? The threat that we might be annihilated by war, the threat that if you die, you might die poor. Both of these, my read of history tells me, are potent drivers for the expenditure of major sums of money in any kind of enterprise at all. So that list you started and that I helped complete, they're all good reasons, but they're insufficient. So my goal now is to convince Congress and others, primarily others, the electorate, that space is an investment, an economic investment. And when you couch it in those terms, it's very easy to say how much you should put in based on how much you expect back.
What do you think about the issues that inevitably, well, they were kind of in a funny way brought up when Newt Gingrich started talking about moon bases, of what happens once we start pushing that frontier out into space as far as who owns this stuff, right? I mean, both the intellectual capital as well as the physical capital of what's in space, it seems like a recipe for disaster given the kind of global circumstances around ownership of stuff.
Yeah, there's no reason to think it would be any different from what has happened here on Earth. You know, the urge to say, oh, space is for everyone and it would be peaceful. What, Earth is not for everyone and we wage war on Earth, but somehow we're going to behave differently when we go into space. I don't have that much confidence in humanity. And so I'm betting that people who create colonies, wherever they land, they're going to annex them to their countries. That's my guess. And if you don't like that, then you got to go make your own colony. And then guess what? You end up fighting about it. Oh, wow. Humans fighting each other over territory. What a concept. You know, I mean, so I'm not convinced, unless you send only scientists to the moon.
Scientists are the one group that's able to not fight over stuff.
Scientists have never led armies into battle. It's just not what we do. All right. We recognize that there is a truth that sits above whatever truth we might be arguing and that we're going to reach that truth one day. So let's keep arguing until we do. But I'm not going to kill you for thinking differently.
In the last couple of minutes we have left, I want to talk to you a little bit about Ray Kurzweil, of all people. I recently saw a fascinating documentary about him, and he talks about this idea of the singularity. And I mention him only as a context. My real question is, as technology development continues to advance, do you imagine that something similar to what Kurzweil describes as the singularity may happen, where the advancement of technology itself outpaces humans' ability to use that technology? Give me your thoughts on that.
Now, I'm not convinced by it. First of all, I'm pissed off he's using the word singularity. That's our word for black holes, okay, the center of black holes. So I want that word back.
Okay.
I'm going to invent some other word, all right? You tell him I said that.
All right.
All right. So apart from that, the brain is a messy, complex place. Human biology doesn't have the precision of machines. It's just a mess. It's a mess, and it has disorders. So to say, one day the computer will pass the human brain, well, I sure hope it does, because ours is completely messed up. Ours is one of the worst data-taking devices there ever was. And in fact, it's our expectation that we are somehow good at getting data that delayed the progress of science for millennia. It was not until we had the methods and tools of science to decode the nature of to decode the natural world without reference to the capacity of our senses to do so. And so to say, we're going to pass our brain, I don't see the what's so special about that. We have machines that pass us physically. That's great. Let the machine do the work. I'll sit home, eat popcorn, and watch the game. You know, I'm not jealous that we have machines that move faster than we do. We call them cars. We have machines that go faster than cars.
But I think the idea would be we still know how to utilize those machines, even though they surpass us. I think more is the idea that technology will outpace even our ability to use that technology.
Yeah, if you look at every single dystopic science fiction story ever written, it takes something that was freshly introduced into culture and then runs it into a dystopic future. And none of those cases have ever come remotely true. Ever. Just to go back and look at it. So the idea, we're going to make a robot, the robots will take over the world. We're going to do, go inside the atom, because then we'll destroy the world. Well, we almost destroyed the world, but we didn't, okay? But usually it's the autonomic thing that people are afraid of, all right? You might set a chain reaction in all the world. That has never, ever, ever, ever happened. So to think that computers will get so powerful that it'll be a singular change in how we interact with each other or with machines, I just don't see that. If the computer has too much computing power, then what I need, I shut it off. I can't get whipped up in this. And then the talk of maybe one day we'll connect the computer to our neurobiology, and then you have thoughts that are in the computer. We essentially already have that, all right?
Right.
And I don't have to plug this in. I just turn it on, and the entire world is at my fingertips here. And that's almost as good as being inside my head, okay? But instead of inside my head, it's here. It's in arm's reach, and it fits in my shirt pocket.
It's brilliant.
So I don't need to plug it into my cerebellum to get the information, because this is good enough for me. What does that do next?
Understood.
I don't know. Maybe something I'm missing here. I don't know.
Understood. The book is Space Chronicles. We've been speaking with Neil deGrasse Tyson. Congratulations on the great book. Really enjoyed reading it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.